Good morning, Christ Church.
Good morning.
Yeah, we got a new sound system.
What'd you say?
We have a new sound system.
I'm not signed, but I didn't want to show yet. So these are the numbers in the back.
I wanted to talk to you for just a second before Linda begins to tell you about a scientific discovery that you may or may not have heard about. Astronomers have found a black hole that appears to be singing in space. You guys know what a black hole is?
Yeah.
It's a star that collapses, and I mean, it's so incredibly powerful that light can't even escape it. But they've discovered that this black hole is basically singing. And it's singing in a particular key, and the key is B flat. I want Linda to play a B flat. In the B flat, starts kind of almost in the middle of the piano. Middle C is in the middle of the piano. So Linda, play a B flat. Okay, now that's a regular B flat at middle C. Now go down an octave. That's one octave down. Now go down another octave. So that's two octaves down. Now do the next one. That's the lowest note on the piano. That's four octaves down, okay? This black hole is putting out a B flat at 57 octaves below middle C. Now that's below anything any human being could hear. A dog couldn't even hear it. But when they look at the frequency that's being generated, it's 57 octaves below middle C. And I'm mentioning that because the Bible tells us very clearly that all of creation will declare God's glory. And even this black hole, this most destructive thing in the universe, is declaring God's glory in music. That's why I'm telling you this. Because even though we can't hear that B flat, we are blessed to live on a planet and in a time where we can hear music, and it has to do with the air moving in this place. And we are blessed to have a beautiful piano that is tuned regularly, that makes beautiful music, and even more blessed to have a gifted pianist that can play it.
Yes.
Each week, we start the service with what's called a prelude, and that's Linda on the piano. And we do that to help you center yourselves, to help cast off all this garbage and junk that happened last week, and to help you prepare for the week ahead. In this time, in this moment, the music is there to remind you that as we even have here, to be still and know that He is God. Linda.
Thank you.
beautiful way to start
off the day.
I love it.
If you're able and willing, we'll rise. Christ Church.
Good morning.
And happy Mother's Day to all the mothers that are out there. There are all sorts of moms in this world. There are birth moms, there are adoptive moms, there are surrogate moms, there are stepmoms, there are second moms, there are single moms, foster moms, helicopter moms, and mama bear moms. We celebrate all the moms today, and we're just so happy that you've decided to join us here in the sanctuary and those that are joining us online. I want to make you aware of a few things that are happening in the church and some of the prayer concerns that we have. If you haven't noticed, we have the soundboard up and running. And we thank you to everybody who donated to that. It's made a huge difference for us up here, and we hope it makes a huge difference for you out there. We are very, very thankful of that. There is a women's Bible study on Tuesdays at 12:30, led by Linda Keeley, and they're meeting at Mickey Clayton's home at 775 on Munson Avenue. If you were aware or not aware when you came in, the new roof is on. They finished that last week, and you'll still see a little bit of dust here and there where they were pounding on the ceiling, but we're getting that cleaned up. We're very thankful that that is done now. A couple of prayer concerns. We continue to lift up Lois, who is with us today, for strength in finding some at-home help to her sister during her recovery. For Aaron Robinson, which is a friend of Linda's, who's dealing with some bladder cancer issues that has spread, and he has surgery, but the reoccurring infections are preventing chemotherapy treatment. So please continue to pray for peace and healing there. Of course, for brothers and sisters in Ukraine, we ask that peace would come to Ukraine and that the military aggression would end there. For Colin Camper, that's Tom and Joanne's grandson. Colin broke his clavicle, and we are praying for healing for his surgery and for pain management. Staff Sergeant Benden Hartman, who is Donna Hartman's grandson, has been deployed to Poland in March, and he's going to be remaining there until December, so we want safety for all of our troops and Brendan as well. Janice, who's a relative of Pat, has stage 4 colon cancer, so we're praying for Janice and that give all those care, giving care to her will be God's hands and feet there and for the treatment itself. And then Gilbert, which is Pat's brother, Gilbert's having some serious heart issues. We pray for the best treatment for his condition, give him peace and comfort. And then Pat also mentioned that Don is dealing with heart catheterization, and they're trying to decide the course of action on that, so we want to keep Don in prayer as well. Linda has made me aware that on May 14th, there's a citywide postal food drive, and as part that's part of the Northwest Food Coalition. As you know, we have a pantry here, and we do quite a bit with that. And we are one of the recipients of that food drive. So anyone who can give a couple hours between 2 and 6:30 at the old Lear building on the corner of Marlow and Airport, it would be much help if you could help out there. You can see Linda for any additional details on that. Will you join me now as we join in our call to worship today because of Mother's Day, found in Psalm 139, verses 13 and 14. For you form my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are your works. My soul knows it very well. Let's worship. come together in this place that you have blessed us with. We are thankful that we live in a free country, Lord, where we can come together to worship you, to call on the name of Jesus, and to move in fellowship with the Holy Spirit without fear of persecution or prosecution. Lord, this day is for you. All that we do here is for you. May you be pleased with what happens here, Lord. We give it to you as an offering of worship and of praise. Lord, as we come together from different places, different walks of life, we ask that you would be with us. We ask especially today that you'd be with all the mothers. Lord, we thank you for blessing them to be a blessing to others. We ask that you would lighten their load today, that you would let them know how much they are loved, and Lord, that above all, that you love them. We ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ and all of God's people said.
Amen.
Amen. Join with me now as we give thanks for the tithes and offerings that have come forth today and throughout the week.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him, all creatures here below. Praise Him above the heavenly hosts. Praise
thank you for providing this place for us. We thank you for calling each of your people here today, both here in the sanctuary and those that are watching online. Lord, as we bring forth these gifts and offerings, we know that you have no need of money, for you created the stars and the heavens and everything that's contained within them. But this is an offering of faith, Lord, that it would be used for the building up of your kingdom here on earth, that it would be used to reach out to those in need, to feed the hungry, to clothe the naked, to spread the good news to those that we meet, Lord. Lord, we ask that you would multiply these gifts as your son multiplied the fishes and the loaves, that in all that we do, that you would be glorified. And Lord, it's in times like this when we come together that we remember the prayer that your son taught us when he said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. You may be seated. Kids, you are dismissed if you'd like to go with Miss Lauren. And at the end of the service, if you'd like, we have gifts for all you mothers up front. Again, good morning. Pastor Jeff is away today. He is down in Ohio, that state that we don't talk about too much, because his daughter Aubrey has graduated from college as a nurse. She got her PIN on Friday, and I believe the service was yesterday as well. So I have the chance and the opportunity to deliver the message today. This one's going to be a little different because Jeff kind of gave me an assignment. So. I'm happy that he did because it stretches me a little bit as well. Chances are that you're here today or you're watching online because you are a Christian or you're thinking about becoming a Christian. You might think that because you're an American that you're automatically a Christian. Well, that's just not so. Becoming a Christian requires that you put your faith and your trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Doing so will forever change your life, and it will also change your forever. It will not guarantee that your life will be easy, that you'll be financially secure, or that you'll become perfect or flawless in this life. In fact, one of the greatest misunderstandings by non-Christians of the Christian faith is that we think that we're better than others, or that somehow we've got it all figured out. We are not better than anyone else, and we do not have it figured out. Christianity is not a path to fame and fortune. No doubt you've heard about the prosperity gospel being preached. Now, to be sure, God can certainly choose to bless anyone he chooses in any way that he desires, but there's no guarantee of wealth or health when you become a Christian. Still others will shy away from Christianity because they think that they're required to follow a bunch of rules. Well, here's a news flash for everybody. As Christians, we can't even follow 10. Right, Lois? We were just talking about this before the service. Let me ask the brothers and sisters here in Christ, has anybody got it all figured out?
No.
No hands. Anybody think that they're flawless in any way?
Yes.
What? Does anybody not sin anymore? No, don't see any hands there. How about this one? Anybody hit the Mega Millions lately?
No.
If you do, we'd like to talk afterwards. How about, does anybody not get sick anymore? No. Not a big one. Has anybody not faced any trials since you've become a Christian?
No.
You see, we're still pretty far from being perfect. But every day we can try to get a little closer by following Christ. But following Christ isn't easy. In fact, it's actually quite hard. It can be costly, and it can even be very painful. Take a look at Luke chapter 9, verse 23. And he, Jesus, said to all, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." And then again, look in James chapter 1 and verse 2 and 3. "Count it all joy, my brothers, when," not if, "when you meet trials of various kinds," there's going to be more than one, "for you know that this kind of, that this, the testing of your faith produces steadfastness. And let steadfastness have its full effect, that you may be perfect and complete and lacking in nothing." It is a process. Denying to self, taking up your cross, meeting the trials you face, testing of your faith. You see, it's not about getting things. It's about sacrifice and growth. And nobody is exempt. Not Adam, not Abraham, not Moses, not David, not the disciples, not Jeff, not me, not you. You want to follow God? Then you better put on your big boy pants, because the journey can get tough. I want to start today by introducing you to somebody I have never met, somebody that you've never heard of, and hopefully one day you will get a chance to meet. His name is Hubert Q. Hall. His family and friends simply called him Junior. Should be a picture of him. That's Junior there. He was born on May 16th, 1924. He graduated from high school in June of 1942. That December of the same year, he enlisted in the United States Army Air Force and became a gunnery staff sergeant the following year. He was stationed in Hawaii and became a gunner in a B-24 fighter bomber. That looks like that. His plane was called the Cloudy Joe. On his 13th mission, which was on May 29th, 1944, he was on a photo recon mission over Saipan with six other planes. Junior was one of a crew of 10 on board Cloudy Joe. About 20 miles outside of Saipan, another plane in the squadron lost its engine and started to fall behind. The leader of the squadron made the decision not to slow down so that the other planes did not become endangered. But the pilot of Junior's plane, Captain Lawrence Stoddard, made the decision to slow down and provide cover for the distressed airplane. Almost immediately, the squadron came under attack from 12 Japanese Zero aircraft fighters. Junior's plane was hit, both the number one and the number two engine were shot out and failed. The strike also ignited fires on the wing and behind the number two engine and another fire in the bomb bay. The crew was able to extinguish the internal fires twice, but they caught fire a third time. The communications between the front and the back of the plane were damaged. In the back of the plane, there were five men. At that point, Captain Stoddard radioed the other planes that they were going to have to ditch their plane into the ocean and gave the order to the crew to start to bail out. Now, as a turret gunner, Junior, if you can put that picture up, turret gunners were in two places. They were up here in the front of the nose, you can see the glass up there, and they were in the back of the plane where that gun is right there. Junior was in the back of the plane. As turret gunners, they were the first people that were ordered to bail out because of their position, they would not survive a water landing, particularly when in distress. Later reports would indicate that two men were seen in parachutes exiting the plane. Captain Stoddard was able to continue to hold control enough of the plane to be able to ditch it into the sea. But the five men in the back of the plane were not seen again. The survivors that were in the plane were thrown out the plane when it hit the water, but they were able to make it to a life raft. They later reported seeing the two men that parachuted out being strafed by enemy planes as they descended, killing them both. Strafing means that they shot their parachutes and shot them in. One of them was Junior. He had just turned 20 years old 2 weeks earlier. Those that were in the life raft drifted for about 4 days, and then they were captured by enemy patrol boats and became POWs in Japan. During the war, they were tortured and some died. In 1945, the survivors were liberated and were later debriefed. That is how we know their story and the fate of Junior. By the way, the plane that Captain Stoddard slowed down for made it back to base. Here's the rest of the story. Junior was the firstborn son of my grandparents, the oldest brother of my mother. He was my uncle, who lived and who died 15 years before I was born. I never knew most of these details growing up, and only found them out a few years ago. My grandparents, my mom, and even my dad would talk about Junior, but I never knew all the details. Just that he was a really great guy, a tail gunner in the Army Air Force, and was killed in the war. Later in life, we found all the documents that my grandparents had regarding this incident. It was pretty amazing to see these documents because these were actual reports that the Pentagon had. They were typed out on old typewriters, as you can imagine, with carbon paper and everything else, so the copies that we have were pretty shabby, but we were able to read through them all. One of the things that I found really interesting, I don't have a picture of it here because it was huge, is they used to make a storyboard, kind of like a comic strip of these incidents. They would have basically cartoonists draw it out so they could explain what happened. So all this that I just described was on one of these storyboards. We had some of the debrief transcripts, photos. We had a letter of condolence, I think we'll see up on the screen, signed by Harry Truman. And then he was posthumously given the Purple Heart. After the war, Captain Stoddard and some of the crew that survived visited my grandparents to personally explain to them what had happened to their son and to them. It was terrible. I think that's why my grandparents never went into any details. It was just too much for them to relive and to share. Many years later, my other uncle, Junior's brother, lost his wife suddenly due to an aneurysm. At her memorial service, I recall my grandmother sitting next to me in tears saying, "A parent should never have to bury their child." I'm certain all those memories of Junior flooded back to her. I've thought about those words a lot over the years. It was one of the first things that came to mind when we first heard that Pastor Jeff and Becky lost their son, Corin, shortly after his birth. And then the unthinkable happened. They lost a second son, Zeke, in a tragic accident at the fairgrounds. A parent should never have to bury their child. I suspect in this room there are some of those that know the suffering and the unimaginable loss, the pain, and the grief must be horrific that either you or someone you know has suffered. Our prayers are with you all. There was another mother many, many years ago that would endure the same unimaginable loss, grief, and pain. Her name was Mary. Now, Mary was a young woman. According to most biblical scholars, she was probably likely a teenager. She lived in a time when women virtually had no position in society. Their life and their future were directly tied to being married and hopefully having sons at some point. It was a big deal, and it was very important to them. But there was something different about Mary, as we're about to find out. One day along comes a guy named Joseph. He meets Mary, falls in love with her, and eventually asks her for her hand in marriage. I want to pause here for a minute so we don't miss something. It's something I've mentioned several times, and I really want to drive this point home. Back in that time, when a man proposed, it was quite different than what we think of today. Both the bride and the groom needed to get permission from their parents to get married. The man had to make sure he was mature enough and that he could provide for the family. The bride needed permission from her father as well. If both got the yes, then the next step would take place, and it wasn't the marriage. Now I want to be sure. There were no he went to Jared moments. There were no great big diamond rings. There was no down on one knee, okay? Instead, what would happen is the groom would approach the bride with a chalice full of wine. The bride had the choice at that point to accept or decline that chalice. If she accepted and drank from the wine, marriage was on. And then the next phase would begin. You're still not married yet. The bride would be surrounded and ushered away by other married women to teach her about being a wife, a bride, and how to manage a household. The groom would in turn return to his father's home, and he would begin to construct a room onto his father's house. If you look at ancient homes, there's a lot of rooms on them. And he would build this room where he and his bride would live. When the room was complete, he'd return for his bride, and then they would be married. Any of this sound familiar to you? It should. Take a look at Luke 22, verses 17 and 18. And then he, Jesus, took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he said, "Take this and divide it among yourselves, for I tell you that from now on I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes." This is wedding imagery that Jesus is talking about here. Christ, the bridegroom, is offering it to his bride, the church. And Jesus is speaking this during the Passover meal. And I want you to remember that this is during a Passover meal, because that's important. But there's even more. Take a look at John 14, verses 2 and 3. "In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go to prepare a place for you, I will come again and take you to myself, that where I am, you may also be. And you know the way to where I'm going." I want you to remember this each time we celebrate communion, like next week we'll be celebrating communion. We choose to accept the cup. We, the church, are his bride. He's preparing a room for us in his Father's house. When it's complete, he will return. This was not lost on the disciples. Okay, this is a very cultural thing that was happening in the weddings. So when Jesus did this, I'm sure their minds were reeling because this is wedding imagery. But let's go back to Mary. She says yes. Things are growing great. Until one day, an angel appears before her and tells her that now she's with child. She's pregnant. Now think about that. First an angel appears before you. And if that isn't enough, he starts to speak and tells her that she's pregnant. She's a virgin. She's never been with a man. And she's engaged. And now she's pregnant? Now praise God this didn't happen in today's society, okay? This happened at a time where people were a lot more reverent. I mean, can you imagine something like that happening today, you know? There'd be somebody on the phone going, "Yo, girlfriend, you aren't going to believe what just happened to me. I'm sitting here doing my nails. I'm watching my favorite movie. And poof, this guy that looks like a genie shows up and starts talking to me. Out of nowhere. And he tells me that I'm pregnant. And I say, what? He says, you're pregnant. And she says, I am not. He says, you are too. She says, am not, are too. Am not, are too. And she says, whatever. And the poof, he's gone. Now, girlfriend, I've never had that happen before, but I'll tell you what, if you want to go, I'm kind of hungry. I want to go to Culver's, and I'm really kind of hungry right now for a hot fudge turtle sundae with some anchovies and pepperonis on it. Can you meet me there? Well, you think it's funny, but how would we react to this? What would be going through your mind if an angel suddenly appeared to you and told you something that startling? How would Mary even begin to process this, let alone explain it to Joseph? What's Mary's response? Not likely anything that you would say. Take a look at what Luke records in chapter 1, verses 46 through 55. This is called Mary's Song of Praise. And Mary said, "My soul magnifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Savior, for he has looked upon his humble state of a servant. For behold, from now on, all generations will call me blessed, for he who is mighty has done great things for me, and holy is his name. And his mercy for those who fear him from generation to generation. He has shown strength with his arm. He has scattered the proud into the thoughts of their hearts. He has brought down the mighty from their thrones and exalted those of humble estate. He has filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he has sent away empty. He has helped his servant Israel, the remembrance of his mercy, as he spoke to our fathers, Abraham, and to his offspring forever." Yeah, I'm certain that's exactly how you'd react, right? Yeah. I don't think so. You see, there's something different about Mary. Mary knew that one day God would send the deliverer. That was known by all the Jewish people. But think about this for a moment. An angel appears to her and tells her what's happening. What's more, she's told that she's carrying the Son of God. Now that might change your perspective just a little bit. Keep in mind, again, as a Hebrew woman, she would know the story of God speaking and angels speaking to people in the past. And get this, the angel also tells her that her relative, Elizabeth, in her old age, was also 6 months pregnant with a son. And remember, this is way before ultrasounds. So Mary believed. Yep, there's something different about Mary. Now, to be sure, Joseph has a story in this too. An angel is also talking to him, but that's for another time. We all know what happens next. Due to the census, Mary and Joseph have to head back to Bethlehem. The Holiday Inn is sold out, and even Motel 6 wouldn't leave the light on for them. So they wind up in a kind of a cave with a feed trough, of all things, as a manger for their newborn son. And a baby is born, Jesus, the Son of God. And everything is going fine until some dirty old shepherds show up. They talk about an angel. Now, you see the pattern going here? An angel showing up, scaring the daylights out of them too, praising God and shouting, "Glory to God in the highest," and telling them that there's a baby that they just have to see in Bethlehem in a manger. And then Mary shows them the child. And then the Bible says in Luke 2:19 that Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. There's something different about Mary. Then sometime later, the Magi, the wise men as we refer to them, show up bearing gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh. And Mary considers these things. Gold, an offering fit for a king, Son of God. This makes sense. Frankincense, it's a ceremonial incense, worthy of a deity. Check. Myrrh. When it's liquefied, can be used as an oil to prepare priests and altars for offerings. Son of God. This makes sense. Oh yeah, by the way, it can also be used to prepare bodies for burial, but whatever. There's something different about Mary. En route to see this child, the Magi inform Herod about a baby who will become king. Herod feels threatened and orders the firstborn males to be killed. Now that's a trial. So Mary, Joseph, and Jesus escape to Egypt until Herod dies. Now you might remember way back in the Old Testament, in Exodus, Pharaoh, who's in Egypt, also ordered newborn Hebrew males to be killed. This was the night of the Passover. The very Passover that Jesus was commemorating when he offered the cup to the disciples. Now Jesus' parents are seeking refuge in Egypt. Because Herod's doing the same thing that Pharaoh did. The story has now come full circle. Now we fast forward 12 years. His parents, each year, travel from where they're at to Jerusalem for a wedding, the Passover, okay? They travel as a huge group because there was safety in numbers, so there would be a large, basically, caravan that would travel from all these towns to Jerusalem. When Passover is over, they start and they head back home. Unbeknownst to them, Jesus stays in the temple. But his parents don't recognize this, that he's no longer with them. I want you to let that sink in. You are responsible for raising the Son of God, and you misplace him. 3 days later, they realize this. 3 days. Makes sense. 3 days later, they rush back, and they find Jesus in the temple. And Jesus responds in Luke 2:49, "Why were you looking for me? Did you not know that I must be in my Father's house?" There's something different about Mary. Time goes by and Jesus grows up. Next, we find Mary and Jesus at a wedding. Mary notices that the party has run out of wine and tells Jesus. She wants Jesus, apparently, to do something about it. And Jesus is like, "Mom, not yet." But apparently, it seems like she kind of insists and tells the servants to do whatever Jesus is about to tell them to do. And then he turns the water into wine. There is something different about Mary. For the next 3 years, Mary watches her son become a leader, a teacher, a preacher, a rabbi. Crowds around him continue to grow, and they begin to follow him everywhere he goes. I suspect that Mary, for all of Jesus' life to this point, is thinking, "Everything the angel said to me makes sense. He's the Son of God. He's going to deliver us. God's plan is unfolding before me. Cool." Now, keep in mind, Mary could not have been a Christian at this point yet, but she was a follower of God as a Hebrew woman. And remember, we know that can often mean that our lives will see trials and trouble. Then the unthinkable happens. Mary's son is arrested and taken before Pilate. The crowd, some of the same people who followed him everywhere he went, saw all the miracles that he performed. Those who were just yelling a week earlier, "Hosanna, Hosanna," now are yelling out, "Crucify him." His disciples, his closest friends, all desert him. Her son is beaten, flogged, spit upon, and tortured. After that, Jesus, with every ounce of human strength that he has left in his body, is forced to carry a huge wooden cross through the town, past all the judging eyes, with all the horrible taunting of the people, and then the unimaginable. With Mary looking on, her son, her firstborn, the child that angels sang and spoke about, is nailed to the cross and hoisted up for all to see. Bloody and beaten, a crown of thorns piercing his head, spikes probably this long, driven into his wrists and his ankles, and then a sign mockingly put above his head that reads, "King of the Jews." She had done everything right. Okay, except for the time when they lost it. Why is this happening? They are killing him. I can only imagine the anguish, the pain, and the weeping of this mother seeing what is happening to her son. She hears her son's voice first. "Father, forgive them." And then, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And then finally, "It is finished." spear pierces his side. Darkness falls on the land. The earth trembles. A mother mourns. Her son is dead. Imagine all the memories that must have flooded into Mary's mind. The angels' proclamations, the shepherds, the star that appeared, the magi and their gifts, gold, frankincense, and myrrh. Myrrh used to prepare a body for burial. Did they know way back then that this was going to happen? Losing and finding Jesus in the temple. All the healings, the crowds, giving sight to the blind, raising Lazarus from the dead. Now he's dead. Who's going to raise him? Imagine the hopelessness and despair as Mary's present reality collides with everything that she has seen and witnessed and heard and knew before this day. Where were the angels now? The shepherds, the wise men, the disciples, where was God? This was his son too. A parent should never have to bury their child. But Mary did, that Friday afternoon so long ago. But 3 days later, everything changed. Everything that Mary had experienced began to come into focus like she could have never imagined. Not only was her son Jesus alive, resurrected, but he is the Son of God. There could be no doubt now. Everything, absolutely everything, had changed. Nothing would be the same from that moment on until the end of time itself. Everything, every single word that Jesus spoke was truth. And now he is alive. But there's more. He was raised to glory, ascending into the heavens, and is seated at the right hand of the Father, God, for all of eternity. There is something about Mary already. She followed God. She was a mom. A mom who loved her son, a mom who changed his diapers, wiped his tears, rocked him to sleep, cuddled up with him when he was cold. A mother that looked on with pride as he grew into a man, and who was shocked as he was betrayed, tortured, and killed. She was a mother who wept and mourned when her child died. There's something else about Mary. It's the greatest part. It was God working in and through her life to change all of history. And it has been recorded for all generations to see, just like she said. He sent his only son into the world to save us all. And that, my friends, is good news. As Christ followers, our lives may not go the way we plan or the way we expect. As Christians, we will face trials. Mary followed God, and Mary followed God's Son. Mary still experienced trials and loss. We all will. But never think for a moment that anything you experience surprises God. He was before you ever were, and he already is where you will be. He has seen everything that you ever have and ever will do or experience. Every joy and every pain. Every laugh and every tear. He loves you unconditionally. He is working in and through your life too at this very moment. I know that it's hard, and it can be so hard, that you will face trials as a Christian. Mary did. Jesus did. And you will too. But the good news is that our Lord is with you, always, to the very end of the age. Have faith. Follow Christ. Be a witness. May the world all know and see that, like Mary, there's something about you too. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you this day for allowing all of mankind to be able to read, to see, to know the truth of what you did through a mother who was faithful. You have changed all of history for all of eternity through your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, as we go through this life, help us to remember that amongst the joy and the celebrations, there may also be pain and suffering. And in those times, help us to remember that you are with us to the very end of the age. We ask this all in Jesus' name. God's people all say
amen.
Amen. Amen.
If you are able and willing, we rise. We're going to do something a little different, and I think you'll understand why. Please make sure you pick up a gift before you leave. And as you go, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Go in peace.